Professor P.C. Kesavan is involved in harnessing science and technology for human welfare, particularly in the realm of sustainable management of natural resources for rural development and livelihood security of the coastal farming and fishing communities. Professor P.C. Kesavan occupied Homi Bhabha Chair and was Honorary Executive Director as well as Distinguished Fellow of M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation, Chennai. He was the former Director, Bioscience Group of Bhabha Atomic Research Center, Government of India, Mumbai, and the former Professor and Dean School of Life Sciences, Jawaharlal Nehru University. His current research links harnessing frontier science and technology with traditional knowledge for enhancing food and livelihood security without causing environmental problems. Professor Kesavan obtained his BSc in Agriculture from Delhi University, MSc from Madras University and PhD from Postgraduate School, Indian Agricultural Research Institute, New Delhi. He is a geneticist and radiobiologist. He is known internationally for his work on elucidation of the pathways of modification of radiobiological effects by kefirin. He has published extensively in research papers in genetics, radiation biology, and sustainable agriculture and rural development. For his research works, Professor Kesavan was awarded with Jesse Bose Medal of Indian Science Congress in 2008 and Jawaharlal Nehru Birth Centenary Award in 2009. With this background, I would request Professor Kesavan to deliver his talk. Professor Kesavan.
Good morning. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Baldev Raj, who is responsible for me to be here. It's very kind of him. I also thank Chairman Raghunathan and Professor Subha Chandran for making my trip to Bangalore and then beautiful place Nayas possible. What I want to do in the next few minutes is to take a journey right from humankind's transition as food gatherers and hunters, that was about 10,000, 11,000 years ago, to doing what they are doing today, to put the planet Earth at crossroads. In fact, I once said in a lecture that Homo sapiens means wise. The humans are so modest, they call themselves wise, wonderful. But what has happened is that over the years, they have sort of done so many things because of their own ability to do it that one should appreciate. But they have done wrong things as well, so that they have degenerated into or de-evolved into what I call as Homo destructus. Now, what I say Homo destructus is something not new. It is based on another Nobel laureate who has said that humans have been so powerful on this planet. You know, humans, if you take as Homo sapiens and our brethren species called Homo Neanderthals, who for some unknown reason suddenly disappeared from the face of the earth about 40,000 years ago. Since then, it is we, the Homo sapiens, who have marched and conquered the planet. All other animals, for example, take the primates from which we evolved, are known for their ability to live in harmony with planet Earth. But humans have made a deviation from that. Their policy had been, in practice as well, had been to conquer nature. This is where we have got into problem. This is exactly the reason why Paul Kersen, a very Nobel laureate, you know, you have known for his contributions to earth physics, astrophysics, and so on. He coined a term called Holocene. If you take this planet Earth, and we have the data, isotope data of oxygen 18, nitrogen, and also carbon data. People have studied, geophysicists of outstanding capability have studied what has been happening to this planet for over 800,000 years. In Antarctica region, dome and they call it. These isotope studies have revealed that Earth has been going through a cycle of 100,000 years of glacial period, that is everything cooling, forming ice. And then this 100,000 years of glacial period is intervened by 10,000 years of warming period, or what you call the interglacial warming period. Now, the last of the interglacial period occurred about 10,000 to about 11,000 years ago. That is the time when humans, until then, were in their birthday suits and were no different from animals in hunting their food and gathering food, became transformed into farmers. They started domestication of animals, and also that is which they call as the farm animals today, and also cultivation of the grain crops and so on. Now, for the next several hundred centuries, several millennia, there was not a great conflict between agriculture and environment, although there was some, because if I must cultivate, if our 10,000-year-old ancestors had to cultivate barley or wheat or rice or whatever it is, no, rice came to be cultivated much later. Wheat and barley were first, and rice cultivation is only about 5,000 years. So about 10,000 years ago, when they started cultivating wheat and so on, they had to cut down the forest trees to make space for farmland. So that was the first conflict between agriculture and environment, because when forest trees were felled and the biodiversity there was destroyed, many species also became extinct, which were dependent on it. But then that was not worse. The real things to happen came somewhere in the middle of the 18th century, 19th century. One Justus von Liebig in Gießen, I had the privilege of having been a professor there in Gießen University for a different purpose, as in radiation physics. That person demonstrated, look, nitrogen-containing compounds stimulate plant growth and also increase productivity. Now the question is, how do you get these nitrogen-containing compounds? For many years, that was not possible. They only used to choose normal nitrate available and apply. Then came Haber and Fritz Haber and Karl Bosch, Swiss Germans. And they developed a process called Haber-Bosch process, by which atmospheric nitrogen and hydrogen could be combined under high pressures and high temperatures to make ammonium nitrate. That was a gift to man, humankind. Because when you apply the ammonium nitrate, the soils are able to provide fertility, the nutrients to the crop plants. That is the inorganic nitrogen fertilizer that we use today. These are expensive, and you know the government has to subsidize a lot of things to the farmers to help them to buy them. The point here is the plants cannot utilize the atmospheric nitrogen. There is about 73% nitrogen, but this is of no avail to them because plants cannot utilize them. However, there are, in nature and evolution, some plants have developed what they call the root nodules and stem nodules and even leaf nodules. These nodules contain bacteria, a very specialized form of bacteria that can fix atmospheric nitrogen as nitrates in the nodules. And when you plow them in, for example, the African tree, Phytherbia albida, is a tree that has all the leaves filled with nodules, and means it is fixing the atmospheric nitrogen very efficaciously. And the farmers used to, the leaves fall and provide nitrogen fertility to the soil. It is so simple as that. Then in other crops, leguminous crops, all the pulses that we have been endowed with the capacity to develop nodules and fix nitrogen themselves. But the main crops, like cereal crops like wheat, rice, and so on, do not have it. Therefore, if you must have a good cultivation of a good yield of paddy, you have to apply something like 100 kilograms of nitrogen per hectare. And where do you get that from? That is mostly in the form of nitrates. Now, this nitrate was a fantastic thing. It was, if I may use the term, was a pivot. It elevated the humankind. Now more rice, more wheat, and so on. And that also provided an opportunity for humans to multiply. What Malthus said, these humans, when Malthus wrote his essay in 1798, you know the global population was only 950 million. And he thought it was a huge one. Whereas today in India, India alone has 1,250 million people. How has it been possible to belie, to defeat Malthusian scourge? It is because of technology. To that extent, we should worship, appreciate technology. But what technology has done, if you look at the same nitrate problem, it is now known, another potential Nobel laureate in Nature published a paper a few years ago saying, the Earth's boundary with regard to nitrogen cycle has been exceeded. That is, more nitrogen has been converted to nitrates in the soil, because nature, what it happens in nature is, for the nitrogen fixing bacteria, there is a counterbalance of denitrifying bacteria. The denitrifying bacteria will reconvert the nitrates into nitrogen and send it to the atmosphere. Now, there is no equivalent opposite of Haber-Bosch process that can only fix nitrogen into nitrates, but not reconvert nitrates into nitrogen. So you are having an imbalance. What is the effect of this? Nobody knows. But one thing is certain. You have nitrous oxide as one of the greenhouse gases. You have it, which is a long-lived one. And you have pollution of the nitrates affecting many river systems, aquifers, and so on. All these are happening. And no way that you can deal with them. There is no technological way to deal with them. So the Haber-Bosch process, which was once a pivot, which elevated, today has become a hatchet. You see that? So there is a very smooth transition from what is a pivot that lifts you and to the one that cuts you. You see? This is not the only thing. Many other technologies. Now I come to Green Revolution. The Green Revolution is a fantastic thing that happened to India. What did it do? Until 1965, I was a student in Delhi. I was not only a student, I was also a student leader. Not like this, the present students of Jawaharlal Nehru University. But I was a Secretary General of the Students' Union. And many times, as many as 3 to 4 days a week, neither would we have chapatis for dinner nor rice. That would come only if PL-480, the American deal, would land a ship either in Madras Airport or Calcutta Airport. Then for us in Delhi, the food grains have to come by goods train. And that will be finished very soon. That was a pitiable sight. That was a time that you must also read the book, Paddock Brothers, economists. They wrote a book. They used the army principle of triage. That is, if you take, for example, countries in those days, East Pakistan, now which is Bangladesh, Pakistan, and other countries, the population is small. If you give food grains, they will survive. But what about India? These people are multiplying like maggots. So they should be written off. Don't give any food grains. So not only was the hunger, but the humiliating remarks contained in that book, famine 1975, America's decision who would survive that book. And Paul Ehrlich's book also was very humiliating. So it is in the background that Professor Swaminathan, along with Borlaug, brought about the Green Revolution in India. Green Revolution, I will show some photographs I have circulated. I think Professor Chandran has already circulated to you. It's a short plant. The idea of a short plant is it can withstand large amounts of food grains on the top of the head, your head, without lodging. So if you want to apply 100 kilograms of nitrogen to enhance the grain yield, then the plant should be short. So the Green Revolution involved the Mendelian principle of breeding to achieve plants which are normally, because originally, when I was a student in Delhi, the Punjab wheat used to be very tasty, but had very long plants and very short panicles, so yield was not that good. So this one's called Sonora wheats and so on. This is a God's gift. I don't want to go into it. It happened in this short mutant form of plant occurred in a Japanese wheat field. And at the time, Japan was under the American rule. And General MacArthur was the general in command. And when Dr. Solomon saw that plant and didn't have to take any permission of the Japanese government, anyway, it was occupied by Americans, and took the seeds to Pullman, Washington. And there, Fogel is a plant breeder. He multiplied and produced wheat plant that yielded 10 times more than the conventional dust wheat in America. Now, it is this wheat that Professor Swaminathan got, and he said that it is because of the cooperation of Bharat Ratna C. Subramaniam, and also the ICS person. Those days, administrators were also very different, Sivaraman. So these three people combined together brought about the Green Revolution. But what is important is that this yield, the Punjab farmers were also something unique. You cannot match them in the world. So dedicated, so enthusiastic. And it is their enthusiasm that enabled the Green Revolution to walk in. And overnight, what happened? India's image within 11 months changed from a begging bowl to bread basket. That was a technology, Green Revolution technology. But even before, at the time the Prime Minister was Madam Gandhi, Indira Gandhi, she decided to celebrate it with commemoration of a new stamp, Beat Revolution stamp, in 1968, June. But before that, Professor Swaminathan wrote, as the president of the agricultural session of the 55th Indian Science Congress that was held in Varanasi, he said, "This is exploitative agriculture. This is not going, this should not be practiced in long term. This is only to provide a breathing space. For God's sake, let us not continue with it. It will harm the soil, it will deplete your groundwater, and the application of enormous quantities of nitrogen fertilizers and so on will kill the soil health, because soil is not an inanimate structure. What supports plant is not an anchorage that a concrete wall can give. It is the numerous microorganisms which are fixing the nitrogen or converting, solubilizing to potash, or earthworms pulverizing the soil and adding to organic content of the soil and so on. So all these put together is what that agricultural, what we call exploitative, that is the term that Swaminathan called. But there was another person by name William Gadd. He was head of the International Agency, U.S. International Agency for U.S. Agency for International Development. And he wanted American footprint on that. And therefore, he called it Green Revolution. It also went against the Red Revolution of the Soviet Union in those days, Cold War days. Whatever the Russians, Soviet Union people did, Americans would like to do the opposite. That is how the term Green Revolution was coined. Now, this Green Revolution over the years has shown what Professor Swaminathan said was true. That is, the soils of fertile soils of Punjab. I went there about 2-3 weeks ago when I had to give a lecture in Amritsar, and I saw the plight of the farmers. Two things have happened, what is predicted in 1968. One is the soils have become denuded of the fertility. The soil water, groundwater has been contaminated, and the soils and people used, you know, there was also a perverse subsidy. The electricity is free. Every chief minister assured the Punjabi farmers, and the groundwater was lifted up, and when it was lifted up, and the water was flooding the soil, and when water evaporated, what it left behind was soil, salt. The soils became salinized. So wheat is not a crop that can withstand high levels of salinity. So that also yield diminished. So what was a pivot in 1960s, which transformed India's image from a begging bowl to bread basket, it today diminished. Punjab is going to face food insecurity. That is the technology. Then on the health side, nowhere else in India you have such high frequencies of cancer. Cancer incidence is very high in Punjab. That is because the people have had to use a lot of chemical pesticides. And this is the thing. So this is what I want you to say. What is the kind? Then the next thing, people are today talking about the genetically modified food. The term is a very mischievous one. Genetic modification should be restricted only to Mendelian breeding, where you make sexual hybridization between two varieties and the whole haploid genome is transferred. That is half set of the thing. Whereas here you take one gene, pick it up, put it to all stressful processes and insert into a recipient plant. Now only two things that the American companies, multinational companies have produced are the Bacillus thuringiensis based pesticide and herbicide, that is glyphosate Roundup based one. These are too dangerous. And let me tell you that I was one of the members of the technical expert committee appointed by the Supreme Court a few years ago. And we had studied the whole thing. And we were convinced at the time that this should not have been introduced into India. Because this will devastate the Indian environmental situation, particularly the soils. And it will also deplete biodiversity, which is very important. And above all, it will lead to a lot of health effects. Now, many of these company people, including my friend who was the earlier speaker, at one point of time was the view that in America it has not produced any health effects. Now, 2014-15 papers I have given to you in the PowerPoint. I'm not showing them because I want to give more time for interaction after I have said a few words. Is that Americans have now shown very conclusively over the last 20 years, several kinds of health diseases, health impairment and diseases have appeared in the United States which went on. For example, at one point of time, in 1980s, they produced tryptophan through what is called a genetically engineered method. It killed 37 people and paralyzed 1,500 people, and litigation to several billion dollars is still going on. Then they introduced in 1994 tomato called Flavor Saver tomato. Now this tomato was in the market shelves for about 11 months. After that, litigation started because it started gastric erosion, or in other words, you can call it ulcer. It started producing ulcer. Then immediately it disappeared from the market. And the reason ascribed was not health, but anything else. Now, what is the way out? This is where I would like to refer in the next 2 minutes to what Professor Swaminathan has developed. Today, if you take India is now having a high economic index. We are very proud of it. But we don't look at the other side. India is ranking very low in human development. India is the home to the largest number of hungry people. 280 million people don't have food before they go to sleep. And India is the home to the largest number of malnourished people, 600 million, because there are three kinds of hunger. One is caloric hunger. You can put some rice or stomach, chapatis in your stomach and see that you have eaten. But protein may not be there. So protein hunger is the next kind of hunger. Third is what we call hidden hunger. It is not enough if you have protein and caloric, but you must also have vitamins, micronutrients, and so on to have a normal, physiologically capable health. That one, if you see, out of a population of 1,250 million people, about 600 million do not have. So what is it that you need? You need a radically different approach, not a mechanized corporate approach. And India is, as a gift, is a blessing that it has got about 150 million small farmers. It is these small farmers who can accept a kind of a farming with nature. Farming with nature, I want to use, because 10,000 years of farming has been against the nature, conquer and conquest of nature. So that attitude of the Indian and every other government should change to accepting, to evolving a method. And where is it happening? Professor Swaminathan has written numerous papers and so on. I have put some of them. And also the fact remains, why is it that 250 million people or 300 million people in India go to bed hungry? There is plenty of food. I can tell you, the world over today, we have enough food in the world to feed 10 billion people. Human population is now only 7.4 billion. But world over, there are 1.5 billion people going to bed hungry. Why? The reason is they don't have money to buy food. So what in Indian scenario very important is to develop access to food, the economic access to food, that can come only with livelihoods. And you cannot, the government's thinking, you know, we can divert them from rural areas to urban areas is something wrong. No, technology has to come to your rescue. What they did in China, I have made visits to Beijing about 4 or 5 times, and I have heard people how much they have suffered. Their social size has been completely disrupted. So that's not a solution. You have to create rural livelihoods, on-farm and non-farm. I have produced a number of different things. One outstanding thing the world over they appreciate is what they call the trichogramma thing. If you quickly show me once, go over the slide, but I want to focus on one thing. Can I do it from here? Or you know, the trichogramma, what they have done, I'm giving you an example. Swaminathan Foundation has developed over 200 different livelihoods. What I want is I have to go quickly over. This is important. This is a picture that I've taken from nature. You see, in three accounts, that is with regard to nitrogen cycle, with regard to the biodiversity loss and climate change, humankind has already exceeded things. That is why Paul Crutzen said, we within the Holocene, now for example, we should be living in a period that is beginning to cool, that is beginning to set in what is called the glacial period. No, humans have finished it. They are become dominant force. They dictate orders to the earth and the solar system. With the result, earth is warming up and warming up and warming up. All these are in here. You can raise questions, but I'm not taking. You see, the biodiversity loss. Today, you have only about 10 different varieties of tomato, whereas at one point, it was thousands. When Cuttack was set as the Rice Research Institute, India is the center of origin of rice in the border of Orissa and Cuttack. There were about 40, 50,000 variety species. Today we have 10,000. What has happened? The anthropogenic destruction. This is the short variety of rice, the end, that could enable the acceptance of large amounts of fertilizers. This is in 1968, he made a statement that intensive cultivation is exploitative agriculture and we should not continue with that. This should only be used as a breathing space. This is the three kinds of hunger: caloric deprivation, people having no food at all, then people having food but they are deficient for proteins, which come from pulses, for in the case of vegetarians, and of course non-vegetarian food and so on. Micronutrient is the vitamins and micronutrients. Now this is a paper, one of the first thing when I got into this field from radiation biology, which is my favorite subject, we showed that how poverty, environmental degradation, climate change, etc., are all interlinked. This is published in Philosophical Transactions, the Royal Society, good journal. This is what I want to say. Here, for example, if you take, there are different forms of rural livelihoods which will give them, they will not make them so rich as to buy a car or something like that, but that will keep them enough food, at least three meals a day they can be ensured of. Particularly one I want to develop is this trichogramma. You see, we used chemical pesticides which are injurious. They are endocrine disruptors and cause cancer over a period of time. There are a number of interesting papers about DDT that was applied about 50 years ago, and the women now, 90% of them having breast cancer in the United States. Now in this case, what happens is you make friendship with the enemy's enemy. You get, if for example, I have got my neighbor having a problem with me, his neighbor will have some problem, so I make friendship with him. So this is the philosophy here. For example, that small wasp here that you see, it goes and lays its eggs on the eggs of the real pest that we have. So the parasite, which is a small tiny wasp, it goes and lays its eggs on the eggs of the pest. So what happens is, now for example, that is Helicoverpa, is a cotton borer. It also spoils your brinjal, bengan pest and all that. Now, that is the wasp on the right side, on that side, Trichogramma. Now, if you look at it, this Trichogramma goes and lays eggs here on this, and it develops, its pupae develop, and the host, that is the pest, is destroyed. Now, what we have done is, this has been made into, this is a science, high-level science. This high-level science was demystified, and these women, rural women who have no land, who didn't have any income, they were trained to do this. And the consequence of that is put there, seven health groups and so on. And in fact, two women were chosen for going to New York, what they call the health youth employment summit, their conference. And two of them, we had to train them because they have never sit in, they have never handled a fork and spoon. And they have never also had the toilet facilities and so on. And they have never sit in a chair. And such of these women had to be prepared to take up a journey to United States and come back. So the whole point is, you see, now they are getting about 2,000 rupees or something like that monthly income, which is something substantial. I'm only giving this illustration, but there are a number of such livelihoods possible. Now, another important thing is the knowledge empowerment. You know, he set up the knowledge lab-to-lab, land-to-lab, that is direct communication between the small farmers deprived of facilities of knowledge and techniques, data, and so on, with the laboratory, with the high levels institutions and so on. And it has also saved lives because we can give information to the marginal fishers who go in artisanal boats deep in the sea, and without knowing that there is going to be a cyclone and so on, they used to die. Now we provide information through incois and so on. Now, another thing you have to prepare. The global warming is real. The sea level is increasing. What do you want to do? Will you give up your paddy cultivation? No. Learn it from Kuttanad in Kerala. There for thousands of years, these Keralites have been raising rice below sea water level, like Dutch polder system. They have developed their own, in fact, far better polder system, and they grow. Now, see what is happening. They can grow rice during some time, then coconuts are also giving them coconut for livelihood, and fish, which grows very easily. This is something that we had also put up in IGCAR for demonstration purposes. Now, the other thing is, there are crops. God has given you enough biodiversity. There are protein-containing crops, oil-containing crops, which love seawater, which love seawater. So the whole near the latest technology that Professor Swaminathan is developing is to develop what is called halophytes. Halo means salt. Halophytes, plants which love salt and grow. So if you take that one, then you will not have the problem. Tomorrow you will get protein, but not from pulses, but from salicornia or some plant. Oh, sorry, Mr. So there are a number of them, cash crops, fodder crops, all that are halophytes which can be grown. So you can start cultivating in around the seashore, because India has got, as you know, 7,800 kilometer long coastline. And if the seawater level goes up, you will have a problem. But this is a strategy, technology, the science and technology. Professor Baldev Raj asked me to talk on this, so this is very relevant to that idea. Then this is salicornia plant. Oil is rich, you can use it as salad, and you can also extract oil from it, and protein. And this grows so well in Gujarat at the moment. Thanks to former the chief minister, now the present prime minister, he had encouraged all this at the time. Now this is a collection of so many different halophytes plants. It's not one, several of them are there. So now I want to skip all this genetic engineering thing which I have said and come to the... This is where words of wisdom. Man has lost the capacity to foresee and to forestall. He will end by destroying the earth. Already humans, as I mentioned, have become homo destructors. Thank you very much.
Are ready for questions?
Thank you very much, Kesavan. Now it is time for questions from the audience. You can raise your flags and then so that I can go one by one from.
There is a long time. I think 1 hour is it for
half life. An hour.
So
is
I think quite a. Yeah. So feel free to ask any question.
Yeah. Yeah, Mr. Appara.
I have heard from Atomic Energy.
Yes.
Just you referred, sir, about the death by cancer in Punjab agricultural field.
Yes.
And recently there was much UN cry in the society that because of the excessive use of the pesticides and the fertilizers, there was a very high concentration of the radio elements in that soil, and that was one of the reason for all those cancerous diseases. So what's your opinion about that, sir?
You see, this is a good question. What really has happened is, you know, Punjab, when I was a student, you know, if I had gone to more places in India, that is Punjab, because many friends, I was also a sportsman and I used to go there quite often when I was a student. Punjab never used to cultivate rice, you know that, in those days. But then what happened, the greed set in, greed, because after the small varieties, short varieties of wheat started yielding, C. Subramanian, Bharat Ratna, told the Punjab farmers that now we have dwarf varieties of rice, koshish karo, try karo, to aa jayega to. Then they tried and it was a bumper crop, rice. It grew as nowhere else in India. So what they did was to put wheat ke baad rice, wheat, rice. Now in the process, the Punjab farmers lost something that was very precious to them. What was it? They used to grow berseem and pulses and other things between two wheat crops or cotton. Crop rotation, jo kehte hai na, this crop rotation was completely abandoned because they have to sell the market. India was buying, you know, the what you call the procurement prices were also made attractive. So I have got so many months of wheat, acha dalo, the next rice too. So it went into a disastrous cycle of wheat alternated with rice with no leguminous crop that would fix the atmospheric nitrogen. The second thing was the political problem or political mistake, which is that electricity is free. When electricity and something is free, then what you do is to use it 24 hours. So they started running their pumps 24 hours to extract the groundwater. Now below a certain level in the earth, there are salts. Now these salts come up and water evaporates. So what settles on the surface of the soil are these salts. And these salts do not support plant growth. And thirdly, when anything grows very luxuriant, you know, when you put fertilizer so much, the plants grow so luxuriantly, and it will attract pests. When they attract pests, what do? The same multinational companies will tell, toh pest aa gaya, toh theek hai, now take this
pesticides. So they also have applied indiscriminately. So this is the problem. Now the way back is that Punjab, many Punjab farmers, of course some of them want to quit agriculture, that is tragedy, but most of them, some of them do not want to quit that kind of agriculture and come into more of the other crops, vegetable. They, some of them have been meeting Professor Swaminathan, who also goes there to give advice and so on. So there is an attempt to sort of change the situation for better.
The adverse effect was not overseen by Swaminathan?
No, I put up a photograph of his there in 1968 in January. There was the 55th Science Congress, Indian Science Congress, held at Varanasi. And he was chairman of the agriculture session. There he said that this agriculture is exploitative. Absolutely. This exploitative agriculture will cause harm to soil, to human health. He has used the word cancer. You will have more cancers in 1968. And what he said is, it is a need of the hour. For example, when India was having, as I mentioned about the Paddock brothers, Paul Eldridge, all condemning India, saying this should be written off. There is no hope for this country. Instead, send food aid to East Pakistan, that is Bangladesh, or Sri Lanka, or some other country. That situation was so appalling. Humiliation was worse than hunger, you see. In that situation, Green Revolution was right, absolutely right to have been brought in. But what we should have done is to have moved away to what we are trying to do now.
We should have warned the people about these adverse effects.
That didn't happen. You know, the political reasons are there. For example, I mentioned Bharat Ratna Subramaniam himself was responsible for inducing Punjab farmers to go for rice.
Oh, no.
You see, disaster. Not that I'm blaming somebody departed soul, but the fact is this is what happened, historic fact.
It's a disaster. Okay.
Sir, it is my practical experience.
Yes.
You made a mention that the various chemicals we are using for growing the vegetables and all that is causing serious diseases like cancer and all.
Yes.
The public is aware of it. And knowing that fact, what I have done practically to grow the vegetable plants, I tried my level best for last 6 months not to use any chemicals to grow the vegetable within my house. But at one point of time, I realized that unless I use some chemicals, I'll not able to get the even that lady's finger or tomato and all. A variety of diseases and coming. Is it due to the climate changes or 20 years back, I did my agriculture work, but I have not faced that problem.
Yeah.
But now it is a serious problem.
You are right.
This is question number one.
Let me
another thing.
No, let me answer this question first, because then, you see, over the years, it is again anthropogenic element that has caused this application of the chemicals. And what chemicals do when you spray? The trichogramma type parasites and predators, which will attack your pest, they are destroyed. A borer sits inside the tissue of a plant. That gets less chemical. It survives. So in other words, in fact, along with the two people, I have written papers on this very subject. What really is it? This is again a short-sightedness of the humans. If I apply chemical fertilizer, everything would be normal. But what really happens is the parasites and predators are outside, are trying to attack your pest. Now they are destroyed. And I must tell you another thing also. In God's gift to mankind, there are a number of plants. For example, here in Karnataka, in Mangalore, a friend of mine, Professor Mattu Madhyastha, he once gave me a lunch which had brinjal sambar, of the kind of sambar I have never tasted. Not only the credit goes to his wife, no doubt, but much more the vegetable itself. Then he explained to me about Mattu Golla, that is the brinjal. And he said that this has never been affected by a single borer. Normally there are fruit and shoot borers, never been affected in his garden. Fortunately, at the time I was visiting him, his garden was full of brinjals, and none of them had it. Really what happens is this, man tinkers the balance of the whole thing with. Now today, world over, what we agree is that no pest can be eradicated, because that's part of the bios. You know, in the Hindu mythology, they talk about the Vasudeva Kudumbakam. That is, all species are interrelated. So even the pests are required. But what we should do is to see that they don't proliferate beyond an economic injury level. You have your share, 2%, 1%, not beyond it, because we need it. You know, this kind of a deal you have to make with the pests. And that is exactly. Today, because of the fact that chemicals have destroyed the beneficial, those who fight for you against the pests, they have been destroyed to a great extent. So this we have to restore. That is the answer. And even now, over a period of time, if you allow, the pests and the parasites and predators will come. And you will see there will be some damage. That damage has to be accepted in principles of biodiversity conservation. Next question is
Parmeshwar.
Thank you.
Sir, when we see in the 60s and 70s, those time, majority farmers, they used only the, of course, this continues the same question, like you used natural menus.
Correct.
But later they started using the fertilizers, other things.
You are right.
Is it not the fact that the health hazards started increasing enormously and a lot of the health hazards spread all over the country? What is the steps, whether government is not thinking on that line to reduce any chemical fertilizer, then go to the natural fertilizer, the menus?
Yeah, your question is a very, very important one. Long before, I mean, tell you that my own grandfather from the police service, he was in police service in Bangalore, and then he moved to doing some farming, was natural manure and other things. Then what happened is, soon after independence, our first prime minister of the country, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, was always having a kind of a fear complex of the Bengal famine. You know, we attained independence in August 1947. In 1943-44, several thousands of people perished in what we call the Bengal famine. So to our then Prime Minister, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, the backdrop to Indian independence was Bengal famine. And he didn't want. That is why in one of the lectures, one of his famous addresses said, everything else can wait, but not agriculture. Now what then at the time the agriculture scientists told was, we have to shift to chemical fertilizers and chemical pesticides in order to boost our agricultural production. So this was a kind of a advice then given to our prime minister that he made this declaration, and immediately he set up fertilizer companies, as you know. One of the first five plan itself, fertilizer companies were set up and so on. So that was the beginning of the end of the natural, you know, the manures and green manures and farmyard manures and things like that. That is true. Today we are realizing it. For example, there are two slides which you must see. People tell you in the country, in our country, you know, in America, people have been eating this genetically modified foods for two decades, three decades, no damage. You know what the reason is? They never allowed the labeling to be put. Never allowed any shop to put this is genetically modified food. And yet, two outstanding surveys published last year in 2015, I've given the reference to you, will show how different diseases have gone up in the United States of America. And therefore, well-to-do people in the United States never buy anything but organically grown food. It is so expensive, but if they can afford, they do it, you know? So that is the secret. So all these foods, you know, food is a medicine in many ways. For example, rice varieties like Navra, in Kerala, they use it for treating some of the bone pains and arthritis and things like that. All these, some of them have. For example, banana that we eat, don't eat it as a fruit, but it's also a medicine. You see, there are a number of things. So if you are going to tinker with them, the chemical composition of these foods, through use of fertilizers and so on, through use of pesticides and so on, and most of the, for example, I'll tell you, since there is time, there was an argument, like cigarette industries, tobacco industry was telling, no, there is no association between tobacco, cigarette smoking and cancer for decades together they managed. Now the Monsanto, the GM company, is doing exactly the same thing, although now recently, about a year ago, now I'm paying full attention to it because I happen to be a member of the Supreme Court appointed committee, And though Supreme Court has not published our report, I am following it up along with some of my friends. One of them is a very dear colleague of mine in Baba Atomic Center. I don't know if you know, he retired, Dr. P.S. Chauhan. See, some of us are following it. And we find amazing revelations today, like health effects and so on. And I thank Mr. Jairam Ramesh, he's a minister from Karnataka. He did such good thing to us by putting moratorium on BT Brinjal. Otherwise, we are a center of origin of brinjals. And our brinjal industry would have been next door. Bangladesh adopted it. They are going through hell of a problem. Their brinjal industry is finished. Their small brinjal farmers are finished. So technology is something. I'm glad Dr. Baldev Raju asked me to talk about science, technology, and agriculture. For agriculture is concerned because food is very vital. My predecessor, my friend Dr. Paduran, talked on medicine, but medicine comes later. First comes food. In a hierarchy of human needs, as Abraham Maslow has said, food is the most basic requirement. If there is no food, there is no health.
Where do you draw a line for striking a balance between technology and its exploitation?
Yes, but who does it? How do you do it? This is the problem. See, for example, a lot of things have happened. The powerful, Monsanto is a $1 trillion industry, powerful. They can do to any extent to change any political power with anything, both influence and there is what is called a revolving door power. The highest paid Monsanto scientist is also now the advisor to Obama. You know that? See, that is the kind of a thing which operates in the world, which is a fact. We have to, because we're all, you know, people, we are not, I'm not exceeding what you call the confidentiality of anything, but these are facts. Facts in a democratic world must be shared.
Yeah. Sir, what is the effect of this chemical fertilizers on groundwater? And if it's so, how it can be prohibited or how it can be?
The number of times, I know number of people have done it. And, you know, for example, the chemical fertilizers that we talk about is not simply a purified compound of inorganic nitrogen fertilizer. It has so many additives, what you call the adjuvants and so on. All these pollute. Today, added to it is a big pollution in the way of electronic waste. People at one point of time used to blame everything on nuclear waste. Then one of my students, who is a professor in IIT Madras, asked me to give a lecture on waste management. And there, it was found, based on data, I could say that nuclear waste is the best thing that is ever contained in a very scientific, effective manner. And also, it is not in the private domain, it is in the public domain. The government has trained good scientists to deal with them. But what do you do with the mobile phones? What do you do with the PCs? What do you do with other things? Each PC of that kind has got so much of heavy metals, and the earth cannot recycle them. So what do you do with them? And more, far worse, is nanowaste. Nanowaste, anything from 1 to 100 angstrom, doesn't have a barrier in the biological system. And once it goes, it commands the proteins to come and form its own organ. It forms a new organ, like organelle at least, not organ, organelle. You know, organelle is a much smaller entity. It forms an organelle. So the medical world is going to be frightened in years to come when new kinds of diseases emerge because of the nanoparticle-based wastage and so on. This is why, in the beginning itself, I used the term human sapiens, homo sapiens have become homo destructors. All other animals, potential Nobel laureate talks, all other animals live in communion or live in harmony with nature. Whereas human nature from the beginning, from the day of Stone Age, they had been how to conquer nature. And nature certainly will be conquered, but nature will have the last laugh. Today in the Scientific American, I think I have got one of these photographs put here from Scientific American. They talk about the planet Earth at the crossroads, at the crossroads. You are in the climate change. Now, another interesting thing, so many meetings have been held, COP meetings about the climate change. Ultimately, the take-home message, as one of the editorial in Nature said, the climate science and climate policies, climate politics are in two parallel worlds. The scientists can go on talking about this is dangerous, that is, but that is nothing to dent the politicians and others who attend. For instance, today, the global temperature is increased, average temperature is increased by 1 degree Celsius. If it goes to 1.5, there will be what is called a tilting point. That is the tilting point. The whole thing will topple over. And the kind of monsoons we expect always, so far India is concerned, so far our country is concerned, we say, okay, the southwest monsoon will come in somewhere off the shore of Kerala in early June or whatever it is, and that will spread across and so on. And then after the tapers, the northeast monsoon will start and so on. But that's not going to happen. Once the equilibrium, the tipping point has occurred, all this will change so drastically that you will not have any understanding of it. And also, let us note, more serious thing, as I was talking to Professor Subhash Chandran this morning, is the intergenerational inequities. For example, let us all, some of us in the wrong side of 60s and 70s might know that when we were young, we didn't have any problem of water, drinking water. When I was a student in Delhi University and my parents were living in Patel Nagar at a distance, I used to cycle up in those days. On the way, I can drink water anywhere. Koi nalka se pani pilo, you know, some, any tap I can drink water. And also, the people were also so kind, they would put lassi, bars and other thing, nimbu pani, all those they would keep. And that was a time which was moved in communion. Today, everybody has to have a bottle of water. Now, let us see what is going to happen in 10 years' time. The size of the water bottle will diminish. Because in our generation time, when we were young, about 50 years ago, that water, each one was able to get about 1,800 liters of water per day. 1,800 to 2,000, depending upon the area. Today, it is hardly 900 to 1,100. And that too because many people don't get water at all. In villages, they have to go walk a long distance to fetch a pot of water. This is the situation. So this is what I call intergeneration. When we were young, we can pitch stumps and play cricket anywhere. So much of open ground was there. I have in Bangalore grown until I was about 10 or 11, and I remember that so much place used to be there. People can run. Today, every inch is filled up with concrete jungle. So the point is, again, you see the intergenerational. You had so much to yourself when you were young. You will have so little to your children. And further, there will be abysmally microscopic dimension of things. This is exactly the technology. So when you talk about science and technology, we have to understand the sustainability of it. The sustainability of it is in regard to the resources. See, way back, one of the slides will show you the paper by Donella Meadows and so on, who in 1972 wrote a paper, Limits to Growth, that is our resources. For nobody can build a house without sand, without water, without stones and so on, and wood. Now all these are becoming rare. This is what they had seen in 1972. And they said, there is going to be limits to growth. Then the powerful lobby in the United States opposed to them. Powerful lobby condemned them. They are mad people, and so on. Similarly, Borlaug, who won the Nobel Prize, was totally anti-environment. Because I'll tell you why. This is because there is time, otherwise you, Mr. Chairman, you control me, okay. See, the thing is, Borlaug at one point of time, you know, 1940, Paul Muller demonstrated that DDT, dichlorodiphenyl trichloroethane, you know, DDT, pesticide, is a remarkable thing. It can kill all the insects. And he was awarded Nobel Prize in 1948, Paul Muller. Then 14 years later, Rachel Carson wrote a book, Silent Spring. You know, there in the Western countries, the spring is a fantastic time because the butterflies come, chirping of the birds you hear, all those things are gone, this silent, graveyard silence. What has happened? Now, Borlaug said, this environmentalist has no business. She should mind her business. Then people studied whether DDT is a carcinogen or not. There were divided opinions. Some 10 years ago, they said DDT is not such a powerful carcinogen. Last year, a lady scientist from Michigan, she showed Barbara Cohen, her name, Barbara Cohen, showed, she studied, went back to California, a particular area, where agriculture was thriving, where about 40 years, 45 years ago, people were putting a lot of DDT and other things. Now they studied, she studied the cancer pattern, particularly in women, of those who lived there in those years. And she has found a very remarkable small window, narrow window. Narrow window is, at the time of DDT, if women had been exposed to DDT, it is 100% carcinogen, breast cancers. See, this is amazing. A narrow window, much of the time nothing happens. But at that particular time, when so many different physiological changes occur, hormonal changes occur, DDT targets. This is a remarkable thing. Whereas with regard to Roundup, what country, both previous government and the present government wanted to allow, is endocrine disruptor. I want to say here, it is 100% carcinogen, and you are going to feed the people. And in one lecture I said, you know, people were, I was giving a lecture in with regard to low-dose radiobiology, which is my favorite subject, and somebody there asked, are you saying that low-dose radiations are not harmful? I said, yes, I'm saying. I'm even adding one more. It is beneficial, I'm saying. And then he said, this is amazing. We thought it is weapons of mass destruction. I say weapons of mass destruction are the genetically modified foods, because everybody has to eat the food, and everybody has to face cancer and other diseases and die. Not this. And go and see the Kerala population, which is living in Chavara and Manavala Gurche area. As a matter of fact, one of the former directors of the IGCAR, Placid Rodriguez, was sharing one of my talk, and then he said, I want to say one thing, I grew up in that area. Had I not grown up, he was given to a sense of humor, and he said, had I not grown up there, maybe I wouldn't have become a director of the IGCAR. You know, so what I'm saying is, you see, technologies are good, and for example, today, everyone should promote nuclear energy. Why? Because Royal Society has seen that that is the only form of energy. The nuclear fuels do not add to greenhouse gases. That one thing will do. Greenhouse gases. Today, if India needs more power and you go for fossil fuels, you will add up. And India is going to be the worst hit country because of the climate change for two reasons. One is the Himalayan glaciers are melting. Already 2/3 is gone from the remote sensing, as we see. And if that happens, Ganges, Jamuna, Brahmaputra all become seasonal rivers like Kaveri, and fighting between Tamil Nadu and Karnataka and all that kind of things. North Indian rivers also will become seasonal rivers. If that happens, just imagine what happens to the entire food production in the country, the entire ecology of the country, and the livelihoods of millions and millions of people along the Indo-Gangetic Plains. So these are the issues that we have to see. It is for these reasons, in one point I said, you must give up this fossil fuel business and set up as many nuclear reactors and so on. It is not because I have been with the radiation business for a long time in my life, but the fact is that this is true. Check up if I am wrong. Yeah. You see, okay. We have to see all these things. Technology means agriculture needs energy. And one form of, in our great-grandfather's time, it was provided by manual labor, as well as the animals, farm animals used to provide draft power. After that, fossil fuels came. Today, if you want more energy, even for agriculture, you have to go nuclear. There is no choice.
Okay. I have a question, Lakshmi.
Yeah, I have an observation, sir. Sir, you told about the soil health. See, the indirectly, the soil health of any country has been spoiled because of the influx of the population. If we can address the issue of the population, probably we could address the issue of soil health also, because we need to sustain the population. Overnight, we cannot reduce the use of fertilizers or any other chemicals. Overnight, we cannot do it. Probably, we need to have a sustained model so that we could slowly do away with the pesticides or chemicals, and then manage the population and then address the issue.
I want to react to it in two ways. The first is, with regard to population, I am 1,000 times in agreement with you. This is what I said. After the independence, our government should have given all kinds of incentives to reduce the population. You know, it is a pathetic thing. Nowhere else in India, nowhere else in the world, we have such a human population. You go to some of the international airport, every fourth person that you see is a Indian. You know, that kind of a situation. That is appalling. You can never achieve sustainability in terms of development because of our population pressure. Let me tell you, that's how it is. The second thing is, if you go to Hyderabad, there is a soil, there is an agricultural scientist by name Anjaneyalu. He was ICR official, and he ICR scientist. He resigned from ICAR system in New Delhi and came and started an NGO, and he has now over 500,000-600,000 hectares of land, all without any tinge of fertilizers or pesticides. Remarkable yield. Now, I have been following it through what is called the International Federation of Organic Agriculture Movement, IFOM, the headquarters in Brussels. And you can see how many different countries have been successful in that. After all, our, you see, one thing I agree, today we have gotten to a mess of population, not only population. My slide will show you population combined with environmental degradation. Now, what is called, Indira Gandhi, in her famous speech in 1972 in Stockholm, in the United Nations Conference on Human Environment, she said, you can't treat environmental degradation alone, separated from poverty. So poverty and this form a vicious circle. And that is so true. So you see, your question is a very well balanced question. What I mean is, these are the answers. One, there is a possibility, but there is no question at all about our not containing the population, you see.
Okay, I will move on to the next question. Nagamani.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, this garbage is becoming a nuisance for most of the cities of the country.
Yes.
So even Bangalore, we have converted that into a garbage city.
Yeah.
So now my question to you is, there are various suggestions given by various people, wet garbage, dry garbage, classification, you know, so many things, and how wet garbage can be converted into useful manure for farmers.
You see, there are, again, there is a slide. There are two things. What we do is also we talk about smart villages, climate smart villages, climate resilient crops. These are terms, for want of time, I did not, now you have given me an opportunity to say a few words about it. The first thing is, the agricultural waste is something that you can convert into useful products. We have trained some of these rural women, landless rural women, to start industry, small micro industry, based on converting the agricultural waste, particularly banana stems and banana leaves, all kinds of things would be littered all around, and in which choking some of the rivers and water bodies and so on. So you convert it into paper boards. And Japan has a great demand for anything that is organic and recyclable. So any produce that, any product that you make out of the agricultural produce is indeed cyclable. Earth is able to do it, unlike certain other things that we mentioned. So that is one thing that can convert a waste into an opportunity. And in every rural area, which generates a lot of agricultural waste, whereas urban waste is different, you know. The urban waste, we have to think of different methods. They're again cyclable and non-recyclable. Things will have to be separated and done. We shouldn't follow the examples of course, Japan and United States. What they do is to dump all the electronic waste into some other country. You know, India has also been, was a dumping ground for a while. And now they are doing it in Japan, in China and other countries and so on. So that is not the solution, because they don't understand one thing. In fact, I told one of the, in a lecture in the United States, I said, United States should take our future of the, you know, there is a report, United Nations report called Our Future, which is, the author of that was the Prime Minister of the Norwegian country, Gro Harlem Brundtland. I've got a photograph of her also here. Maybe it is here. Ah, this is it, Gro Harlem Brundtland. And you know, she wrote Our Common Future, that is the title of her report, Oxford Press. And there she says, notwithstanding the geographic and political boundaries, our ecologically, our destinies are intertwined. America cannot say, I have dumped it in India, because the effect of it globally through atmosphere and water is the same. So that is why she titled it Our Common Future. Irrespective of the political frontiers, the fate of humankind is ecologically entwined. So dumping doesn't solve the problem. You know, it won't be delayed reaching you, and so on. So the whole point is, urban, today we have to, you see, this is where I find, in, you know, I am not against what you call Mahatma Gandhi rural employment thing that's going on, which is good. But in addition, there must be a movement to start off some of the rural livelihoods in this manner. See, now whatever we have in the country are at the demonstration level, largely brought about by MS Swaminathan Research Foundation and one or two other NGOs. There must be a national policy that you supplement the free food donation or the rural employment for 100 days, etc., along with this. If only they do that, there will be what you call the generation of interest. For example, when somebody is fed free, he doesn't think he has to work. You see, so there must be a compulsion. Necessity is absolutely very essential. I think one should strive for that. That's exactly what I think.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Next, Nandakumar.
Sir, as we all are aware, agriculture in India is in doldrums.
Exactly.
And you have suggested natural farming as the effective way of countering or rather solving the problems. At the same time, we know the farmers, when they are not having any alternative, they look for immediate solutions. And there is a lot of misinformation campaign regarding organic farming, all these things. Or everything is termed as organic farming, and it is all this information are fed to the farmers. Naturally, agriculture university should have been a solution to advise the farmers to move in the right way. Can you elaborate the concept of natural farming, which you were highlighting, so that they can take it forward?
Yeah, it's a very good question. You see, there are two kinds. One is what is called the organic farming. In the international sense, organic farming is a very rigorous one. That is, the soil should not have any even parts per million of trace of any chemical fertilizer or chemical pesticide and so on. So to get a certification of the international caliber is very difficult. Although what happened is, in Tamil Nadu, in Kolli Hills, we found the tribals were cultivating pineapples and millets. When we had the very sophisticated testing done of the products, we found they didn't have any residue of fertilizers, pesticides. And that is because they were too poor to afford any chemical fertilizers or pesticides. So it is a kind of organic farming, not by design, but by default, that they couldn't afford. Now we immediately linked them with some German companies and so on. They are now getting, and some of the ragi and other materials that we are getting to reinforce, or what you call the fortification of the nutrients in cereals, come from those villages. And they have now become well-to-do. Well, the other thing is, what if you can't achieve that level of organic farming is also possible in two other places. I spent about 5 weeks after the tsunami, 2004 tsunami, in Andaman Nicobar Islands. The Lieutenant Governor was very kind to us and had given a helicopter, so I went with four others to survey the whole thing and to give a report to the government how the unsustainable, because paddy cultivation was done there, which is ecologically and economically unwise. This was thrust upon by the British, because most of the people in the circular jail were either Bengalis or the Tamilians and others, you know, from South India. They eat rice, and therefore they said, you cultivate it. Now, that is not wise. We made a lot of suggestions. The coconut there, a number of Nicobar Islands, are naturally grown. Every coconut is organically certifiable. Now, has the government done anything about it in spite of a report? Nothing. So ultimately what happens is we have knowledge accumulating in individuals' pockets and the shelves, but nothing is translated into action. Now the other kind of agriculture, which is less rigorous than organic agriculture, is what is called green agriculture. In the green agriculture, I'm giving an example. If you say that your paddy requires 100 kilograms of nitrogen per hectare, I will not apply all the 100 kilograms in the form of ammonium nitrate or something. Instead, I will partition it. I will give 10% in the form of ammonium nitrate, 20% in the form of what he said, farmyard manure or natural manure and so on. Rest maybe in the form of legumes. That is, there are, for example, Baba Atomic Center had done a marvelous mutant. You know, there is what is called Sesbania rostrata. It came from Australia. It produces nodules in the stems, very unique crop. Now, this was having what is called photoperiodic limitation. That is, it can grow only when there is a long day length. like in summer. But if you want that to be, normally what they do is to grow suspension and plow it into the soil, then raise a crop of paddy or wheat or whatever. So the long day length was interfering with this. So Bhabha Atomic Research Center induced radiation-induced mutations in them to knock out the sensitivity to photoperiodism. It's a remarkable piece of work from Bark. And today, we have Suspenia that you can grow, and it will add about 40% nitrogen to what you say. So in other words, this is a kind of agriculture, not organic, but green agriculture. In the green agriculture, I'm saying you deviate from the chemistry-based agriculture to a large extent towards nature-based. That is the point. It has to be transition. But with regard to yield, I may again like to tell you what I said. Anjaneyalu in Hyderabad, fantastic yields. The ICR has made visits, but ICR, unfortunately, let me tell you very openly, is caught between Monsanto's GM crops and Anjaneyalu's organic crop. And Monsanto will pour trillions of dollars. Now they want to take over our agricultural whole operations. Whereas poor farmers cannot put even one naya paisa. That is the difference, what controls the whole thing.
Okay, next question.
Sir, we have started converting salt water, saline water into fresh water.
Yes.
So don't you think, sir, if we do this on large scale, then again it will create ecological imbalance?
Ecological balance will not be achieved, because where will you put all the salt? You know, so many problems will arise. See, this is what one has to see. It is exactly the same as Haber-Bosch process. You converted the atmospheric nitrogen, plenty is there. And today your earth has got so much of nitrates. And that is going to cause a lot of other problems as yet unforeseen. Some we have seen, some we know, some we do not, we have not yet seen. So this is the problem. In technology, what happens is, for example, today we have an extravagant lifestyle. In that, every day you see, in between the cricket program, if you are watching, you will see 10 advertisements. Don't use fog, use this body odorant, that, all kinds of things. The fundamental question is, does humankind need these? Can we not live without deodorants and all kinds of things? Now, if you take, for example, ordinary bath soaps, you can get anything from 13 rupees to 300 rupees. One new soap I saw about a few days ago, one bar was costing about 90 rupees or something, 95 rupees or something like that, small one. So the point is, the industry today, for example, technology, when you talk about technology, the science-based technology has been diverted by few to make money. And that exactly is the reason. Take, for example, let us say we are the third richest country in the world. And why is it that you have human index, development index, something like about 130 out of 200, and global hunger index, 52 out of 138. Your Bangladesh and Sri Lanka have better indices than us. Why? These questions cannot be answered by anybody. Not Mr. Jaitley, not by anybody else, because these are facts. You cannot.
Okay. Okay. Pankajiro.
So you mentioned that in context of Punjab, that salts coming out of deep ground water has contaminated the soil. So is there any way to get rid of that?
Or? Yeah. That is being done. But you have to change your method. If you want to reclaim the soil, that is the word, reclamation of those soils is possible. But again, you have to deviate from that corporate-based approach to what is required as a family-forming kind of thing, where you grow different vegetables, different crops, don't grow for the same wheat and rice. Instead, go for vegetables, go for other kinds of things that are salt tolerant. And over a period of time, the salt dilution will happen and salt concentration will come down. See, the whole idea is, if you look at the nature has a business of harmony and cooperation, all the processes. Take hydrological cycle, take nitrogen cycle, everything it has balanced. Whereas what happens when science-based technologies are redirected towards only making money? Many technologies are good. They have solved human problems. If, for example, we still are able to exist on this planet, despite Malthus's warning, it is because of technology, no doubt. But what I'm saying is that technology, when it's not properly used, and some technologies we promote wrongly, what is one example of a technology that we are wrongly promoting is genetic modification of organisms. No doubt about it. You have learned. So many people died in the United States. No, doesn't matter. Go ahead. Right? That is the wrong thing. You see? And then again, we all know all countries in the world are hungry for energy. How do you produce energy? There are ways, but we don't want to follow them because you create what you call all kinds of imaginary problems. You talk about Fukushima. Let me assure you, as a radiation biologist, Fukushima has done nothing to human health. Let me talk about Chernobyl. Compare Chernobyl with the Bhopal gas tragedy. Chernobyl is a small thing. Maybe less than 100 people died here and there, and none genetically affected. Whereas in Bhopal, how many thousands died? Where is the focus of the humankind? We talk about Chernobyl, and we here have imaginary problems. Says no for nuclear power reactors. But there, if they want to set up one more chemical industry, humankind probably would be more generous. You see, these are the issues.
Thank you.
Sir, okay. I just want to ask you, this why West went for GM food at all? There was no need for them. It is a sparse population. But why they went for GM food at all?
You want me to tell the exact answer or what is told?
No, you
tell. Exact answer is to conquer. India, for example, many of the developing countries cannot be enslaved once again, like the British did. You can only hit, for example, Dr. Baldev and others conducted two Pokhran tests. We could not have conducted this kind of test had we been still importing food from the United States of America. We couldn't have had the political sovereignty. We couldn't have had the national food security. And we have them. So how do you knock them out? Let me ask you a question. Simply that. Once again, these people. For example, I have told you, BT Brinjal in Bengal has destroyed Brinjal industry. And today they want to put it, some of them, again, there are reasons which you know, but I don't want to explain. People can be bought, even from our country. And once that happens, for example, at a time, let me tell you this much. When I was a member of the whole thing, somebody asked me, sir, your daughter is in the United States? I said, yes, you're right. And she's married an American. Yes, all right. I said, sir, why don't you make a trip? I said, my wife and I made a trip. What is the problem? No, sir, this time we will give you business class. And you can also go on to visit that St. Louis. They will give you $500 per day, but we will put up all. What is the reason for? And let me tell you, without naming the person, he came to the foundation 3 times to meet. And every time, one time I had to go through the back door, get out. Once the security told me so-and-so has come, an American giant, first time, I left all my bags in my office, in my secretary's room, and went through the back door, through what you call these generators and all that kind of thing. And my driver doesn't come until about 2 o'clock when I go, but this was about 10:45 or so. So I went and hid in some place and told, I have a driver, bulao. See, this has happened. Now that explains. And so far America is concerned, many people, including my daughter and her husband, do not touch any of this food. They get organic food. More priced, but they get it. So ultimately it is, you know, it's a capital society. The feeling, for example, what Obama wanted to do, the healthcare and other things, did they succeed? So that is the whole thing. Now the idea here is simply political, not food. I will tell you one thing, you can quote me. The existing crop plants which the Monsanto Americans have developed will not increase the food yield like Green Revolution did, even by 1 gram per hectare, 1 gram. Quote me.
Okay.
What is the need for it? And the Monsanto company, which has put the HT, what is called herbicide tolerant, is also the manufacturer of Roundup or the glyphosate. They say, Mike, your crop will take more, so put more, I will sell it. That's it.
Yes, okay, sir. Actually, I'm the farmer, came from farmer family. Till my degree, I did myself agriculture.
Good.
The difference what I'm observing from those days in these days, whatever the seeds we are using for the next crop, previous yield whatever from the crop, whatever getting, same thing we are using for the next crop. So that is one thing. But now we are unable to use those things. We have tried, but there is no any sprouting of those things. only whatever we are getting from the market. Those are only...
I got your question. Let me answer.
One more thing.
I know what you say is farmer cannot save the seeds for the next season growing. Farmer cannot save the seeds. He is unable to save the seeds from this crop to sow the next crop because it doesn't do well. That exactly is the scientific principle. Behind the seeds that are produced, BT cotton, HT cotton, everything has got that. That is known as GURT principle, GURT, G-U-R-T. That is genetic use restriction technology. The seed will kill itself if you sow it. The reason is, unless you go to the producer every time, how can he make profit? Yes. Supposing I have sold you this time and you are going to use your own seeds, mera kya ho jayega? I'll be pauper. You have to come back to me every time. For example, the BT cotton seeds are sold at 1800 rupees per 400 grams. Desi cotton for 90 rupees.
Yes.
When a farmer buys, I'll explain that. I agree with you. 1800 rupees, 1200 rupees go to Monsanto out of that. 600 rupees, Mexico has to take it shore. Then the farmer sows this 400 grams of seed and his problem begins with the sowing because that is a hybrid. It requires much more water than your desi cotton. It requires more chemical fertilizers. It requires more pesticides because the BT against borer, but white flies and jassids and aphids come and attack, against which this has no solution. Okay? So the farmer commits suicide. One slide I have put it, how in the Californian scientists have analyzed that the farmer's suicide in rain-fed areas of Maharashtra is directly related to adoption of the BT cotton.
Okay, so one more thing. Earlier days when we are growing the vegetable plants,
okay.
Vegetables, they are putting some flower plants and some other different plants and all to attract the pests and all, so
yeah,
that
right.
Major vegetables will not be damaged.
You are right, absolutely right. That is the wisdom, traditional wisdom.
Yes,
they have lost that.
Now the present,
right.
They are not following
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely. You are talking from practical experience, I see. That's
yeah, myself, that's
yeah.
What...
No, that is very obvious that you are a farmer. You have experience. That's
and one more my observation.
Yeah, please.
Now when, at the time, now I am at Sriharikota. So there are so many different types of trees are there. There they are not using any pesticides or any things and for the any growth thing. Some trees when I joined there some 25 years back, same trees, they are giving a very good size, more yield, big size fruits and tasty. Same plant, now it is not, no yield, size is not there and taste also is not. So what is the reason?
You know. No, not that. Senescence is true.
We are not able to understand.
Yeah,
so what is the... it may be due to climatic changes or soil changes.
No, climate is indeed causing a problem, no doubt. But it's, unless you scientifically establish that it is entirely due to climate change, we cannot talk about it loosely. That is one thing. But the soil conditions have been deteriorating. That's well known. For example, it takes about 400 years to form 1 centimeter of topsoil, which is fertile, which can support growth. And you can lose it in one day. You know, see that kind of a problems are there, soil related problems, soil fertility, because you apply pesticide spray and that goes to the soil and immediately the earthworms, which are pulverizers of the soil, which add organic content to the soil, are killed. And many favorable or beneficial microorganisms are also killed, you see. So this is a process that is set in with the application of anything that is chemical, which is not natural.
Okay, we'll have one more question from Rajari.
Sir, I have not one but three questions.
Go ahead.
Maybe an observation. The first one is, what can be the future policy plan for producing food, either by technology using synthetic fertilizers and biotechnology or things like that, or by traditional knowledge with organic manure for sustainable living, number one. So you answer, then subsequently
okay.
I'll tell.
See, the first question is, this is exactly what, if you go through the slides, they will show you how a transition is taking place. Professor Swaminathan calls the new system-based approach that he has introduced as the Evergreen Revolution. And he defines it as producing, achieving high levels of productivity in perpetuity without causing ecological or social harm. Now, for example, in the case of Green Revolution, yet another thing that happened was the paradox, a paradox of mountains of food grains on one hand and millions of hungry people on the other. So we should avoid that also. So this is integral, this approach is integral part of evergreen revolution, where what you do is, now there are, literally speaking, world over people, some of them very outstanding brain, not only here, Professor Swaminathan, but, you know, people elsewhere have also written, McArthur and Scher and so many other people have also done a lot of experiments to come up with how good the farming with nature is. Only thing is, our mindset has changed over a period of time. We think that chemicals will produce wonders, and therefore we want to judge. That is exactly one of the questions that I earlier encountered. But the point is that if you allow your time, that is why I refer to Anjaneyalu in Andhra, and he has done over 500,000 hectares, and ICR is not wanting to take it because the pressure is from elsewhere. You see, these are the things. Second question.
Okay.
Will you be recommending this particular point to the government, or whether government is having any plans to implement?
I am too small to tell government what they should do. But these are all in the published domains and so on. And if there is a meaningful, like it happened in those days of Swaminathan when he brought in the Green Revolution, if there are those kinds of people, yes. If, for example, a minister is now going to follow the footsteps of Monsanto, then he will not do it, let me assure you. But Jairam Ramesh was different, and he did it.
Okay. Restrict yourself to question later.
Yeah, number third question I will go. Second, I am skipping.
We have done already.
Yes, sir. Sir, any factory product is priced according to the standard economic models. Fixed price plus running capital overheads, like that only. Typically, example is a cement manufacturer fixes his cost, price of a cement bag, whereas a farmer is not allowed to do so.
No, it's not
one of the reasons for farmer suicides in Andhra Pradesh and
there are number of, for example, dealing with anything inanimate, whether concrete or steel or cement, is different from agricultural production on the field. You have numerous problems, both anticipated and unanticipated problems. You see, for example, in some cases, in some years, we had over production of tomatoes in Andhra. And I was traveling, somebody said, sir, 1 rupee, 5 kilos. I felt sorry for that farmer. What can he get with, that means he's desperate. That situation is on one hand. On the other hand, black marketing and not availability of foods, for example, onions in September month, in Delhi and other places, you sell for 200 rupees a kilo. So the whole point is somewhere our production system, supply production demand system, needs to be looked into, and it should be balanced before we can talk about the prices and other things.
Okay. Last question from Simpa Roy. Yeah. Simpa Roy.
Good afternoon, sir. Long time back, I have seen one program in DD Doordarshan, where it was shown that some farmers of some areas are injecting hormone to accelerate the life cycles of the vegetables. They have taken small bursts of that vegetables, injected the hormone, and within 1 or 2 hours, it grown in such a shape that they can sell it into the market. Now my question is, what kind of steps, it is a long time back I have seen, we have taken to stop the inflow of these type of vegetables in market, because as a consumer, we can't differentiate them.
Absolutely, you're right. You see, there are a number of methods that are going on. Tomato ripening, mangoes and so on, mango season is coming in, and all kinds of these things are done. I think it is highly deplorable. The condition of food safety evaluation in our country is not up to the mark. This is a fact. You see, so many things can come in. For example, there is a big story of Monsanto suing India, government of India, over a particular gene which they had produced, found in some what you call Indian variety. I don't want to go into the details. And ultimately, it turns out we don't have any means. If somebody gives a seed, that's a tragedy. Anybody can do anything and get away with. Food is indeed, if it is not properly managed in terms of safety, can become weapons of mass destruction. You see?
Yeah. Last question, please.
Sir, it is my observation is that Hormones, they are producing grains, vegetables, but they cannot store that thing, and due to that they don't get money. Because they are forced to sell that thing immediately, but the profit is in the businessman, they get the profit. So some years they don't get money, and so how the government, is there any plan that the government is thinking that farmers should have that type of capability of storing the foods or vegetables?
Again, I've got to tell, let the cat out of the bag, in the sense. The government of India had appointed a commission called the Farmers Commission, Agriculture Farmers Commission, of which Professor Swaminathan was the chairman. This report was submitted in 2004. It had not seen the light of the day. Why? Because he had recommended that India needs to build about 5,000 silos, which will be probably 1/10 of the 2G scam money. If it could be spared, Punjab farmers would have been able to store their wheat and rice in godowns, not on the roadside. That would perish with rain. So the whole point is this: the technology is available, but the government of the day must understand what the people need. And it thrives on vote banks, not on our wisdom, not on our findings, you see. That's the tragedy.
With this, we'll conclude a wonderful interactive session by Kesavan.
Thank you, sir.
I will ask Dr. Nagamedi to present vote of thanks for this session.
So I can come there.
Absolutely.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's my proud privilege to propose vote of thanks to Professor K.C. Kesavan for delivering such a thought-provoking lecture. I should tell you, it was really very emotional, and we could feel the concern you have for Indian agriculture and mankind as a whole. Really, we were all moved by this, and the interaction what took place really threw more light on your knowledge and concern and what you want to do for the humankind. The way in which you put things, good and bad, that has gone from science and technology to agriculture, it's really an eye-opener for us. I don't know who is going to really translate these things into action. Really, we are waiting for that. But still, I'm a very optimistic person. I feel a day will come or a revolution will happen very shortly so that man stops destroying the planet, and he will also survive in a better life. So on behalf of all the participants here, and on my personal behalf, and also on behalf of NIAS, I would like to express my sincere thanks to Professor Kesavan. Let us give him a big round of applause.
Sir, please note, you have the maximum number of questions in all the...
Yes, it was. It was very nice. And yeah, it was more related to life of each and everybody here, so it was very nice. I thank Dr. Raghunathan for conducting this session, and thank you all for making it so effective, so nice, and so informative. Thank you so much.